Sabbath will have no end. Come on, somebody. You ought to be waiting on your feet. Is surely everlasting. Amen. Come on, somebody. Give God a praise right there. It is good. Thank you, Lord. You know, every time, every now and then, it's just good to go off script and give God an impromptu praise. Amen. There's a praise that seems like it comes out of nowhere. Amen. You know, one of them old folks didn't have to do it, but he did praise it. Amen. There's sometimes it ain't no rhyme or reason. And I would see my grandma walking across the kitchen, and every now and then she get a double clutch in the step. Out of nowhere, a double clutch in the step. She get a hitch in the giddy up. I look at her like, what's wrong, mama? And I look at her and give God some praise. I thank you, God. You didn't have to do it, but you did, God. You made a way out of no way, God. God, woo, God is good. It's that kind of anointing here. Can I say that? Amen. It's that kind of anointing here today, amen. See, that's the kind of anointing where you ain't got to wait for nobody to lay hands on you. Amen. Hey, nobody got to save you happy. Ain't nobody got to preach you happy, God. You just think on the goodness of the Lord, amen. And all he's talking to you, and your soul begin to shout. I'm going to tell you what. If your soul ever begin to shout, the rest of you ain't too far behind. Thank you, Lord. Come on, somebody. Give God a praise right there. God is good. Thank you, Lord, for all your goodness. Amen. But come on, let's have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, right now. For this special type of anointing that is in this place. There was an anointing in this place, God. There's an anointing for deliverance. There's an anointing for extra power. There's an anointing for your grace, for your peace. Oh, for your prosperity, for your healing. There's an anointing in this place, God. I thank you, God. I thank you that we are in the place. We're going to be contenders for the anointing. Amen. We're going to be contenders for the anointing. I thank you, God. And now, God, I pray that you send me your preacher, God, for the hour. The type of anointing that's going to make preaching easy. The type of anointing, send it to the congregation that's going to make hearing easy. And the type of anointing that's going to make it for all of us, preacher, pastor, and congregation, make it easy to do the word and the word and the will of God. And while you're partnering us in that kind of anointing and power, partner with us in your covering. Cover us with your blood. Never know who we are and who in the world we mess with. In Jesus' name, we do pray. Amen. Amen. And amen. Let the household of faith say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Today, amen, for our time together. Amen. I know some of y'all might be sad. I don't have a series to start on this week. No, I got something a la carte. Every now and then, it's good to just get the menu. Amen. But you, amen. And I want to entitle this sermon Armed and Dangerous. Amen. Armed and Dangerous. And to some that may seem like an odd title for a sermon, but can I tell you from the oracles of God, Armed and Dangerous is just what God has ordained for us to be. Can I tell you that God created us in his own image, and there is nothing weaker or any quicker about the God that we serve. Come on, somebody say, praise the Lord. The Bible says in Psalm 24:8, it says, who is this King of glory? It says, the Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. Can I tell you the fact that God is mighty in battle means that he is not afraid to fight. He is so enough good at it. Amen. So we need to know that God is not opposed to us fighting either. It is recorded, amen, in the Bible, in the book of Revelations, chapter 12, 7-9. It says that there was a there was a war in heaven. How many of you know where there's a war, you've got to fight it? Amen. And Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought, and the dragon's angels fought, but the dragon and his angels did not prevail. Can I tell you that dragon was the devil? Amen. And then the Bible says that now he was thrown out. There was no place for him again in heaven. And that great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil, and Satan, which deceived the whole world, was cast out into the earth. And if angels would cast with him, can I tell you, when the devil show off, God rise up. Amen. I want to show you that example. When the devil show off, God rises up. God will rise up, amen. And God will go looking for the fight. Amen. And I just want you to understand that it's all right to be ready to fight. It's all right to be armed and dangerous, church. The Lord has been trying to prepare many of us for battle for a while. But too many of us have the wrong mentality about being in a battle. Amen. See, we got the wrong idea. We think that just because the Lord called us to be meek, amen, that we're supposed to be weak. No. Being strong in the Lord, strong in his might, strong in his righteousness. Amen. We got to understand that we are in the battle. Amen. And we are called to fight the good fight of faith. When Jesus walked into the temple and he saw the buyers and the sellers and the money changers and the cheaters and the artists, he jumped over tables, took a couple of ropes, put them together, and ran them out there and said not. Can I tell you that sometimes good people can't stand by and let evil run and reign? We got to be ready to fight, amen. But let me show you what the fight is all about, because I don't want nobody to think they're going to put them up with their neighbor, amen. They were proud to talk about, amen. The Bible says in Matthew 11 and 12, and from the days of John the Baptist until now, of the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent taketh by force. Church, your scripture is saying from the time of John. On the revelations and the promises of God and his will, before John, they were given to the prophets and the priests. Everybody couldn't get a revelation from God. Amen. But then in order to possess the promises that God was giving you, sometimes you had to fight a physical fight. Amen. God promised Abraham the land of Canaan, but it was 400 some years later that his children had to go in to fight to possess the land. I'm just telling you that when God was giving his promises in the Old Testament, you actually had to go out and do some physical fighting. Amen. Oh, come. Somebody say, thank the Lord for new grace. Thank the Lord for new grace. You see, now, because John has come, because John the Baptist has come, and he's preached repentance, and he's preached salvation, and he's preached the kingdom of God. Oh, God is at hand, or right at your doorstep. God has a brand new type of warfare. That warfare is no longer physical. God ain't calling the Goodwill Baptist Church to go out and find some Hittites and Perusites and some Amorites and some Canaanites and some Philistines to go whip up on. But God is calling Goodwill to stand in the face of the devil and do work. Somebody needs to know it's all right to be armed and dangerous. Allowed himself to speak to us in such a way that we need to know that our fight is no longer physical, but it is spiritual warfare. See, what the Lord does of himself or through us in the spirit has a greater effect on the world than those things and those things in the physical world than what we could do of ourselves. Can I tell you that just because it looked like you ain't got the money to pay a bill, just because it looked like they about to put you out your house, just because it looked like your rent or car note is way behind, just because it looked like the doctor said you will not be well, just because it looked like you won't gonna see your 95th birthday. God said, not so. Amen. Not so. He said, not so. Not so much out of your mouth, but he said out of the mouth of God, out of the Spirit of God. And when God said a thing, and God called a thing, and God decreed a thing, that thing in the heavens, it is loose on the earth. The Spirit within you got more pull on this world. That's why folk think that they can trick the vote. They think that they can bamboozle the people and have their will done. Whatever way God wanted to be on November 3rd, that's how it's going to be. Amen. The Spirit is in charge. Can I tell you, see, when the Spirit of God moves, the world was formed. When Jesus prayed the prayer of faith and the Spirit, he touched blind eyes and they were healed. Why? Because the Spirit began to move against the natural, to cause that natural thing to line up with the Spirit of God. So when I tell you Matthew 11 and 12, the violent taketh by force, it is not speaking of a violent act against someone, but rather an intense act of seeking the manifestation of the power of God that is abundant in God and God's kingdom and available to those who are willing to contend for it. You know what a contender is? It's somebody that's in the ring trying to fight him. Amen. You can't be a contender sitting on the sideline. You can't be a contender sitting in a seat of do nothing. You can't be a contender unless you're willing to stand up and put up holy hands. Amen. Tell the devil that he will not rule, he will not walk to and fro in the earth, he will not devour, but you will stand on the word of the Most High and the living God. Somebody need to know it's all right to be armed and dangerous. Amen. Now text today, amen. We want you to know, amen, that God first wants us to put on our fighting gear. There is a certain attire that you use to go into battle, amen. And Ephesians chapter 6 began to describe just what God is looking for, amen. God wants us to put on the whole armor. Somebody say whole armor. Not the half armor, not the quarter armor, not the under armor, but the whole armor of God to be able to fight against our enemy, the devil. The text makes it real clear that we are not fighting an enemy that is human. Amen. Sometimes folk do stuff to you want to fight them, but it ain't them. Amen. You got to look beyond that. Amen. You got to hug your neighbor, love your neighbor no matter what, and know that it is an enemy, amen, that's trying to come against them and you. It's just that they might right now, and they might be working for the other side and don't know it, amen. But that's why we pray for them that despitefully use you, amen. That's why we love them that despitefully use you, amen. Because like Jesus said, Father, forgive them, they know not what they do, amen. Ephesians 6:12 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against the principalities and the powers, and against rulers of darkness in and of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Amen. That's who we're fighting against. The Bible begins to say in verse 13, take on the whole armor to be able to stand and to fight against the attack and the very face of spiritual warfare. Can I tell you, and when it's all over, you'll still be standing. Can I tell you something about that little scripture right there? I used to think that scripture meant to fight the enemy till you got so tired you couldn't do nothing else but to stand there. And it used to be a theology that said there's an honor in being able to just stand and be useless. There's an honor in just standing in the devil way and letting the devil pick on you and let the devil talk about you and let the devil slap you around and let the devil knock you down. There used to be an honor in that. We was taught, amen, in order to be Christians, we almost had to be a punching bag. Amen. That's how we was taught. We was taught like that because that meant the more we could take, the closer we was to God. Amen. God ain't calling nobody to fight and you whipped. Amen. I'm just telling you right now. He ain't called you to fight and be whipped. The Bible says stand. The Bible says stand. When you done all, stand. I begin to see that in a different way. Amen. See, you don't have to stand defeated to
before the enemy. When you're standing after you have done all that the Spirit has called you to do, you really standing in victory. You wondering where your next opponent at. You're standing in the joy of the Lord. I'm standing in the strength of the Lord. I'm standing waiting on my next opponent. Amen. But the sword I'm going, I know the devil's got a whole lot of him and devils, and he ain't finished with me yet. I ain't fooled by the victory today, because there will be another battle tomorrow. And I'm standing here. I'm standing in the strength. I'm standing in the anointing. I'm getting my rest in the Lord. I'm building out my strength, because the devil, when he come back, I'm going to still be here. Amen. I'm going to still be here, and I'll be able to stand in the victory. See, when you stand in the Lord, you are standing in God's success. You are standing in the victory, Brother Victor. Oh, you got a good name, boy, Victor. Amen. You are standing in the victory, Victor. Amen. You are standing in success. Amen. You are standing in the power and the might of the Lord. So we know that God wants us to be able to fight. Amen. We know he has given us this spiritual armor to put on, but just what is that spiritual armor? Let's look at the weapons of our spiritual warfare that God has given us. The Bible says, for verse 14, to stand therefore having your loins girt about with truth. Amen. What is this truth? Well, can I tell you, John 14 and 17 says, even the spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, amen, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, amen, and shall be in you. Who is the spirit of truth? It's the spirit of God. Who is the spirit of God? It's the Holy Ghost and the fire. Jesus said in that 14th chapter, I got to go away, but I will not leave you comfortless, but I will, but my God will send you back another comforter that will be in you, be with you, lead you, and guide you. And when you wrap yourself up in that same Holy Ghost anointing, that's the beginning of your spiritual warfare. See, your loins girt about with truth. That's the belt where you can hang all the rest of your goodies on, where you can hang the rest of your armor on. If you don't have the belt, you can't put on the breastplate. If you don't have the belt, you can't put on, you can't gird your feet. If you don't put on the belt, amen, ain't no need of you putting on the helmet, but the rest of you exposed. How many of you know you need the Spirit of the Lord to stand? Spirit of God to be able to be in this warfare. You need to understand that that's the name for the Spirit of God. And I tell you, I won't go to no fight. I won't even pick up a finger if I ain't fighting with the Lord. Amen. Come on, somebody. It's all right to be armed and dangerous. The B part of verse 14 says, it talks about that breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate is the protection for your body. It is made of metal, able to withstand the attack of the enemy. The breastplate of righteousness is not your righteousness, but it is rather the spiritual righteousness of God. See, the Bible says in Isaiah 64 and 6 that our righteousness is as filthy rags. I don't know about nobody else. I got on some rags right now. They're not too filthy, but I got on some rags right now. If you were to shoot something at me in the natural, I love this dude. I had it for a long time, but it can't protect me if you want to get to me. Amen. This is just as filthy rags. But when I put on the whole armor of God, when I put on the breastplate of righteousness, you can do some stuff to me. I'm like a weevil. You might hit me and I might fall down, but I get back up. You wonder why I'm still hanging in there. Why am I still hanging in the fire? Why you can't kill me? Why you can't talk about me and make me cry? Why you can't get at me? And I got the breastplate on. Bam! I got the breastplate of righteousness on, and not my righteousness, but it's the righteousness of God. Amen. Amen. The Bible lets us know in 2 Corinthians 5 and 21 that Jesus became unrighteousness for us, so we can put on the righteousness of God. When we we put on the righteousness of God, amen, we are able to arm ourselves with God's character. We arm ourselves, yes, with his righteousness, but also with his love. Yes, with his righteousness, but also with his holiness. Yes, with his righteousness, but also with his patience. Amen. We've got to take time to arm ourselves in the Lord. Then in verse 15, it says to be shod with the preparation of peace. And I tell you, I'm going to teach a minute. Amen. Peace is more than just the absence of conflict. Amen. The word peace in the Bible, it translated as shalom. Shalom talks about it talks about a divine peace. El Shalom, God of our peace. It's a divine peace that God wants us to have as our spiritual armor. It don't just mean absence of conflict. And anybody that's ever been in turmoil know that the absence of conflict is good. But peace also speaks of a wholeness, a successfulness in your life, a place in your life where there is no lack. You gotta get the right shoes on. You know what I'm saying? If you're standing up all day, you got the wrong shoes on. No matter how cute those shoes are, they're gonna get to hurt your toes. Amen. You got to put on the right shoes. You got to put on, get your feet shod with the preparation of God's peace. And when your feet are shod with the preparation of God's peace, then you are covered with the gospel. And the gospel prepares you to walk in spiritual places. And how many of you know when you walk in God's spiritual places, you begin to walk in the anointing. You begin to walk in victory. You begin to walk in success. Not in one place in your life, but in all areas of your life. This is what the gospel does to you. Jesus said in Luke 4:18-19, I am anointed to preach the gospel. Preach the gospel to the poor, those in lack. I'm anointed to preach the gospel to them that need to be healed. I'm anointed to preach the gospel to the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captive, and the recovering of sight to the blind. The anointing of the gospel. And when you take time, before you go out to fight the devil. You see, the devil will get you hemmed up when he make you worry about your situation. You going out trying to fight the devil and know your home about to be foreclosed. Where your mind at? Where your mind at? Your mind back on your home. And the devil know he got your mind distracted and he can take you out. But when you got your feet shod with the preparation of God's love and prosperity and peace, the devil can't trick your mind no more. You know why? Because God got it already taken care of. Amen. When the gospel of peace is preached in your life, the enemy will have a hard time getting close enough to you to throw your spiritual game off. But I'm telling you, church, you got to be willing to arm yourself. You got to be willing to arm yourself in the word of God. You got to be able to hear the word of God, the gospel of God. And when you hear it, you got to be good grammar. You know the parable of the seeds and the sower. He just sowing all over the place. He sowed on some stony ground. He sowed on some ground that had weeds. He sowed in some ground that had no depth. But he also sowed in deep ground. And the only thing that took root and lived and thrived was that word, that seed that was sown on the good ground. You can't expect the preparation of God's peace to come within your life until you get your heart and your mind and everything else mixed up so you can serve the Lord. Come on, somebody. I want to be armed. I want to be armed and dangerous. Amen. Then the Bible talks about in verse 16, the shield of faith. Can I tell you that it is your faith in God that keeps the weapons and the attacks of the enemy at bay. Your faith is your shield. Amen. Your belief in the word and the abilities of the Lord to protect you and make you a fearless soldier. And when we are made a fearless soldier by our faith in God, we see that no situation is bigger than God. No situation is impossible in God. Ain't no weapon formed against me shall prosper because I believe in God.
Then the Bible said the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word. The helmet of salvation, can I tell you about? It is part of the army, of the armor that most affects your head, and in this case, your mind. I'm about to, you better listen real close now, because I'm going to tell you something off the beaten path. You might not get this everywhere, but stick with me. Amen. Often, we think about the heart when we think about our seat of our emotions. We think about the seeds in our hearts. We think about that it is our heart that makes us righteous, or it is our heart that makes us unrighteous. Can I tell you, according to the Bible, amen, the heart does not determine our relationship status with God.
All right.
Amen. It does not determine our status with God, but according to the Word of God, and you know I got a word for you, the good heart is not the first step of our salvation. The Bible says in Philippians 2:5, say, let this mind be in you. Let this mind, see that his heart, let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Amen. Romans 12:2 says, and be not conformed to the world, but be transformed, not by the renewing of your heart, but by the renewing of your mind, that you might be able to prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Somebody give God a praise right now. He's alive. Will you be able to prove that will, that perfect will of God? It is when God begins to save your mind. When God begins to save your mind, then the rest of you will get saved. Then your mouth will get saved. Then your hands will get saved. Then your feet will get saved. You'll be able to talk right, walk right, and be right. You'll be able to do the will of the Father and live in harmony with the Word of God. Not contradicting the Word, but obeying the Word. Transforming, renewing your mind. Amen. And your mind will not listen to the tricks and the traps of the enemy, but it will stay on Jesus. The transformed mind will be able not only to abide in the Word, but the Word will also abide in you. But that mind that is fully suited, it will become a mind that is fully suited to the whole armor of God. And then the last piece of the armor is the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. It is the Word of God that we begin to live out all the promises of. It is the Word of God that we begin to hold close to our heart while we're in the battle. We can say that the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. While we're in the battle, we can say the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. While we're in the battle, a day in your cause is better than 1,000 days in the tents of the wicked. While we're in the battle, we can say in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and there was not nothing made unless it was made by Him. I just want you to know that the Word is good. The word is good. The Word is everlasting. The Word is full of grace, and you need the Word to be armed in the Lord. And I just spent some time telling you about how to be armed in the Lord and put on the whole armor of God. But can I tell you that it's more to the story than that?
Amen.
Too many times we as preachers don't stop right there with the whole armor of God. But Paul began to go further. If you look at the 18th and the 19th verse, Paul began to talk about prayer. He began to talk about supplication for all things, asking that which you will. He began to talk about something that is important to being armed and dangerous. The devil don't mind you putting on your stuff. Can I tell you? There's a whole lot of folk in the church that got that stuff on and ain't doing nothing with it. Amen. Amen. They got the battle stuff on. They got on all the right gear. They look fresh. They look clean. They look like they know what they're doing. But
is something missing. They're armed, but the devil knows they ain't dangerous. Because there's one thing they have not done. Like Jesus told this rich young ruler, he said, I've done all I was supposed to do from my youth. Jesus said, it's one thing you lack. And I'm telling you today, I ain't gonna have no halfway equipped soldiers underneath my army. You are my army in the Lord. I am your shepherd. You are my sheep. We are marching up the king's highway. And I ain't got time to run back and get you because you ain't got all your weapons on. Put your war stuff on and let me ready to go fight the devil. We're gonna fight the devil. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Paul went further than the armor. Paul began to say something that's important. You cannot be dangerous to the devil until you get like God. God has equipped you with the stuff. See, God don't need armor. He is God. God knows you need armor. And see, you need the helmet. You need the breastplate. You need the sword, the shield, the feet shod, the girdle. The girl all around you with the truth. God knows you need that. That word is good for you because it gives you confidence in him. Yeah. But you got to have also confidence to be like God. God, when he created, when God saw that the devil was running rampant on the earth, you know the devil was here because it was nothing but darkness and chaos. Yeah. That's what Genesis said. God said enough of that. God stepped out of heaven, stepped onto nothing, and God began to speak a word. God began to speak a word. He spoke a word and said, let there be light. He spoke a word and said, darkness behave. He spoke a word and hung the sun. He spoke a word and he hung the moon. He spoke a word and he hung the stars. He spoke a word and he divided the sea from the land. He spoke a word and he divided heaven into the heaven you see, to the outer state and to the heavenly places where he exists. He spoke a word and he brought forth sea creatures. He spoke a word and brought forth land creatures. He spoke a word and brought forth cattle and animals. He spoke a word and said, let me make a man, and took his own hand and created. Amen. We need to learn, amen, if we're going to be like God, if we're going to be armed and dangerous to the devil, like God put the devil in his place in the beginning, we got to speak a word. We can't just be armored up. We can't just look like we can fight. We got to be able to fight. And we can't fight the devil with this. But boy, can we pray? Will we pray? How Father, that heart be happy. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. When we begin to pray to God like that, God said, I see you trying with your little armor. Your armor ain't enough, but the words out of your mouth and the meditation of you out of your sight, let them be acceptable in thy sight, oh Lord, my strength, Lord, my redeemer. Amen. Somebody need to tell the devil, I'm armed up, I'm ready to fight, and according to the word of God, it says. Somebody need to tell the devil, you are a liar, you are not the truth, there's nothing lies in you, it finished. Somebody need to tell the devil that the joy of the Lord is my strength. I shall not be dismayed, I shall not be swayed. It finished. Somebody need to tell her that I am the head and not the tail. I am the lender and not the borrower. It finished. Somebody need to tell her that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, and whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. It finished. It finished. Because I'm all